future, and I'm very much comfortable that I'm under your chairmanship, so that I will speak from my heart in a very comfortable way, thanking the IDSA for the kind invitation to be in this very important event. I was in the previous one, which was sort of a prova, probably, on the same topic of West Asia, and I think it is, as mentioned by the Minister of State from the Ministry of External Affairs, that the IDSA and also the Deputy Director of the IDSA, to have a mechanism of this type to organize such a conference regularly, with also the speakers of this morning, that these crises in the West Asia, it seems, unfortunately, will last for longer time. And we have to live with it and see it and see how to face the challenges. That I think it's very important conference, and once more, thanks to the IDSA. Now, coming to the topic, I think the previous speakers made my task easier because they covered most of the points, and I can promise the chair that I will stick to the time then. I think we all agree that the growing of the hotbeds in West Asia and North Africa is challenging and really of a big concern to the people of the and the governments of the region, as well as the world over. And this requires that the regional forces in North Africa and West Asia, as well as internationally, should bring their efforts together to face these challenges. It cannot be done by the people of the region alone. And I will come to the subject of India later, but we had the Minister of State expressing readiness of India as a region close to West Asia, South Asia, to take their part in helping to overcome such a situation. But this I will come to it at the last part of my presentation. Now, to overcome these shortcomings which led to the crisis, I think the countries of the region under the discussion in this conference needs to elaborate some politics, how to achieve stability. And here, besides security measures or whatever measures will be taken, we have to ensure the citizens' partnership in any process to achieve stability or to overcome the crisis. And for this, the region should be built based on noble norms, well known to us: democracy, freedom, and prosperity in the sense of the development. But to see the problem, from my view, if we go back to the mid of the last century, when many of the Arab countries got their independence, and there was in the friend who is not with us here, but he's with his heart with us, using the IT, from Turkey, had referred to some of the history when these countries were, they got their independence in North Africa and West Asia. If we follow the development of the politics there, I agree with him that at the time when Nasser was in power in Egypt, then the pan-Arab nationalist was the main trend in the politics in general, and even is popular among the people. But then we saw some shift after the 1967 war and the Israeli-Arab war, and in the end of the 60s until the end of the Cold War, when the Soviet Union collapsed and the Eastern Bloc was dismantled. That period, from the end of the 60s until the end of the Cold War, the most popular trend politically in North Africa and West Asia was the left forces. Many nationalists, they tend to be left, and because of their relation with the Soviet Union and East Europe. But after the collapse of the Soviet Union, end of the Cold War and so on, also this type of force of the left has retreated. And there was a vacuum, to my view. And of course, the Islamic forces who were there for more than 7 to 8 decades in the region, mobilizing the people, came and filled this vacuum. But some of them, they went to the extent that seeing this type of popularity to go in a very dangerous direction with terrorist acts and so on, which we are seeing nowadays. Now, seeing what is the shift in the situation in West Asia now after this 2010 and 2011, the changes which took place. In North Africa, of course, Islamists came to power. In West Asia, they were trying to come to power. To my view, I don't agree with many of the terms used on these changes. It's wind of change, which lead to a transitional period in the region. And this change partially was regional forces' involvement to carry the change, and the other part is with international factors, and we have to admit this fact. And why the this thing? I mean, here is a question really, and I share with the House, is the reach of the natural resources in the Middle East. First speaker, I learned from him this term now about the rentier economy in the region. I'm welcome to learn this term. So my question is that this rich natural resources in the Middle East, is it a curse or a blessing with all the developments which is there? Why I'm saying this? Because, we are having a difficult life in the region. With Al-Qaeda and all its terrorist work in North Africa, West Asia, Al-Nusra, now ISS in Iraq, and they are extending up to the border of Lebanon. They have oil fields under their hand. They have rivers in the territory where they are functioning, having the Khalifa, cities, dams. And the question is, they are selling the oil from the oil fields. Who is buying it? How they are sell these oil and then get sources for financing their destabilizing, I would say, movement to the region. Buying weapons, again, from whom they are buying the weapons to behave like a state in a very wide region. As the chair has mentioned, that these developments and these crises would last for years. I think the Minister of Foreign Affairs of France shared with you the opinion, and he said it in a statement that this will last in the region for more than a decade. But to the surprise, as my Egyptian friend has already mentioned also, the president of the U.S. in the beginning meeting with some journalists, he said that U.S. has no plans yet to face with this matter. Of course, then with the pressure here and there, they said that they want to take out this danger of the ISIS. Particularly after we saw ISIS beheading two US journalists in 2 weeks, then the US said they will be involved, and I think they will be involved deeper and longer in facing this crisis, to my belief. For the present geopolitical situation, we see that there are several civil wars in North Africa, in West Asia, in Libya, and in Iraq and so on. But there is no center. Mostly they are sides. And involvement of the international community in a region with no center to address the involvement, you become a side by yourself. Here I would like to refer to also to Zahrawi declaration that they are opening a Al-Qaeda office or branch in South Asia. To see the scope of the crisis and the challenges going beyond North Africa and West Asia to the region here, and even the King of Saudi Arabia in a statement said that the West and even to the US, they should see that this threat will reach them as well. As the chair is asking me to take care of the time, I just want to emphasize that there are social conditions also that produce such phenomena as ISIS, and this social condition needs to be altered. And political reforms, economic developments are very much needed if we want to face these things. It's not only a security measures which is required. And we hope that also the international community, particularly the West, will not, focus their attention on the Ukraine crisis, and then should not revert to the spirit of Cold War and make Europe as their chief focus. Because, as previous speakers have said, such a phenomena needs an international coalition to combat terrorism. Very briefly on the situation in Yemen, but then in the interaction we can, if time does not serve now, highlight more. In these winds of change, of course, the youth and the women, which are new forces, I would rather say, took part in a peaceful demonstration for a better life. This also requires that if there is any new situation in North Africa or West Asia, there should be focus on best practices in education, in the social media, to achieve, hopefully, religious tolerance in the region. I think also I have to say some few words before the Yemen issue is this in the Israeli-Palestinian question. Some said that these challenges are isolated from, I don't think so. Still, it is linked to it. And Israel should realize that there is even a consensus among Arab and social sectors in Israel that Gaza war will end like 2009 and 2012 war. The chair is an expert in the region. He can also share his opinion. And if it continues like this as a status quo, the siege will continue on Gaza, and Palestinian suffering will continue, and then project of hopelessness of solution to the Palestinian-Israeli conflict will continue, and this adds to the factors which, gives some soil for extremism in the region. To the issue of Yemen, in very brief way, and then if there is any question, I'm ready to talk. We realize that it is a transitional period, and thanks to the initiative of the Gulf Council, the former president, who lasted for 33 years, agreed to step down for a new president elected. And in the transitional period now, as a result of a national dialogue, a draft of a constitution is under work. And the idea is to have a federal, civil, democratic country unfortunately, at the moment when I am speaking with you, to my belief, the situation is very critical, and it seems some of the warlords are not happy that we succeed in 2011 to avoid civil war, and they are escalating the tension in Yemen to maybe bring it to at the edge of the civil war. Let's hope that the transitional period with the support, because the international community and the Security Council unanimously having a common position on Yemen, lucky enough, and they had three resolutions in the last 2 years of the Security Council. The last one of them is putting Yemen under Chapter 7 of the Charter of the UN to follow the situation, and whoever do obstacles to the transitional period, that the Security Council will deal with them. I'll stop at this level, and thank you very much.